The war in Afghanistan has been raging since 2001. Wave after wave of young men and women have been through its horrors.
Any casualties? Any casualties?
For one platoon, catastrophe struck on the 10th of July, 2009. Nearly half of them would be injured or killed. It remains the bloodiest day for a British foot patrol in the history of the campaign. This film is about four men who survived that patrol, but are still trying to get over the mental scars. Alex Horsfall was the boss of the platoon. He lost a leg in the attack, but today he's more worried about whether his men can recover from their mental injuries.
Post-traumatic stress does arise from a tour in Afghanistan. It's a horrible disease, really.
Peter Sherlock, known as Shirley, is haunted by the terrifying memories of what he saw on that day.
And in these nightmares, it's exactly the same as it was when we were out there. So, pretty scary.
Matthew Ramdeen was on the patrol and thought he'd got through unscathed. But for a time, his mother could see he was in trouble.
I'm in tears. Every day I'm in tears. Every day I'm waking up, going to work, thinking he walked out the street and killed someone.
Kevin Holt, known as Holty, can't forget the carnage of the ambush and has been living with the consequences ever since.
I had mood swings, anger problems. I smashed up my room, smashed my TV up, everything. And I don't even know why.
For one of their friends, the memories of that day proved impossible to live with, and he took his own life.
The nightmares, the flashbacks, the memories, the loss, it was too much in the end for him to cope with. I suppose he saw it as the only way to get peace.
It's 3 years now since these young men returned from Afghanistan, and yet the terrors still torment them. Over the course of a summer, we'll follow them to see if they can win the battles they still fight. It's the third anniversary of that fateful patrol when five men were killed.
Today is the 10th of July, which officially makes it the third year anniversary of when we all got blown up. I decided to go up and see the National Memorial Arboretum in Staffordshire.
Alex is an old Etonian and, after uni, joined the infantry as an officer. He now lives by himself in central London, but on the 10th of July 2009, he was in charge of the patrol that was ambushed. It's a date etched on his memory.
It's a date that you actually remember more than your birthday. It's sort of 3 years, hey, I'm alive, and you know, at the same time, it does come along with the deaths of five guys in the platoon. Down here in the middle, you've got the names of the five from 9 Platoon. William Aldridge, James Backhouse, Jay Horn, Joe Murphy, Danny Simpson. What's quite nice to see as well is the flowers there, all dedicated to the five. I was very, very close to getting my name written up on this wall, but I had several riflemen looking after me. That's why I think you sort of come here to also say thank you, because they did a bloody good job, and it is thanks to them that I'm still here.
Alex still feels responsible for the men who died that day and for those who survived the horror. He's made it his mission to get them all back together for a reunion.
There have definitely been a few cases of things like post-traumatic stress, and so there's definitely issues, and I suppose getting everyone together is maybe a sort of quite a good soothing way to sort of deal with things like post-traumatic stress, being able to sort of talk amongst your friends who are there, who know what you're talking about.
One of the lads Alex would like to get along to the reunion is Peter Sherlock. Peter came back from Afghanistan haunted by the terrors and had to leave the army in 2011 to escape the constant reminders. Since then, he's relied on drink to drown out the bad memories.
Can I please have a pint of Foster's and a Cronenberg? One Pete.
A new kettle of brown ale, please.
And a new key, please.
Peter has a young daughter, Hope, but he's no longer living with her mother and he doesn't see his daughter as often as he would like. He's moved back with his parents near Salisbury and they're trying to do what they can for him.
You really only drink out of boredom then? Is that what you're saying?
If I go out when I am down, like really down, then I come back in a right state. I wouldn't be able to walk or talk properly.
All he wanted to do was drink, really, when he came home. It was really sad. And, you know, I asked him about it, why he was doing it, and he said, well, for a few minutes, a short time, I can forget, and life's normal.
Another survivor Alex wants to get along to the reunion is Matthew Ramdeen. He left the army 6 months after the tour, but he found he was still living with the fear of improvised explosive devices, or IEDs.
It was difficult to adjust to civilian life as it was before. Walking down the street, you think, am I going to set off an IED with every step I take?
He moved back to live with his mum, Jo, in West London.
Paranoid when he came home. Things like shutting the windows, making sure things were locked, and then look out the window just to make sure we weren't being followed.
Walking over a drain that made a noise, you know, that would set you off. You hear a loud bang, you jump and you think, what just happened?
The member of the platoon who's going to be the hardest to get along to the reunion is Kevin Holt, or Holty. After the tour, Holty was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD. He left the army in January 2011 to try and escape his demons. His moods are still very up and down. Kevin is living with sister Jess, and that means he gets to catch up with her fiancé, Brendan, who's an old friend from the same platoon.
I had mood swings, anger problems. One stage, I smashed up my room in Maine, in the block, back in Ballykinlow. I smashed my TV up, everything. And I don't even know why.
Out of anger.
Yeah. I still have dreams. Obviously, I still get flashbacks and that. To be honest with you, I haven't really been able to sleep.
For the men involved, life changed forever on that awful day. 2 months before, Alex and his men from 9 platoons, C Company, 2 rifles, had been posted to one of the most dangerous places for British troops in Helmand province.
This is my old Wishton patrol map of the area we were operating in.
Their base, Wishton, was set in the hostile town of Sangin. One of Alex's right-hand men was Rehan Pasha, or Pash, to his friends.
This is Pash. He's the squares got your way in all situations.
As well as working in a school, Pash is in the Territorial Army, and in the spring of 2009, he'd volunteered to do a tour of duty with 9th Platoon as a Lance Corporal.
Well, hey.
Their mission was to try and bring security to the area, and that involved them patrolling the maze of alleyways around the base.
We're pretty much all kitted up. We've got all our stuff on, and we're just going to go over to the loading bay.
Their first month in the area was relatively quiet. But as the days passed, they started to find an increasing number of IEDs.
10 seconds.
And Wishon's always been considered as one place on Earth where there's no lack of IEDs, should we say, during our time there, that only sort of increased.
This footage was shot a few weeks before the terrible ambush. When they went out on patrol on the 10th of July, nobody was filming. For some of the men, the events of that day are still too traumatic to describe, but their leaders are prepared to relive what happened.
We started off in Wishton here.
And they came out this little exit here, and they patrolled down the Wishton Bazaar.
Alex was leading the patrol. Pash was with the reserve force, watching on.
We'd go one way, we'd find an IED, so we'd be sort of slightly pushed, slightly channeled.
Came out towards a clearing at the end of the Wishton Bazaar here.
And basically ended up just about here against this sort of low wall overlooking this entire valley. And that's where the sort of first IED blasts went off.
The explosion was not just one bomb, but a daisy chain of them. It ripped through a section of men in the patrol. An 18-year-old rifleman, James Backhouse, was killed outright. Alex was also caught by a blast. His leg was blown off and most of a hand. Five other men around him were also injured. Alex's memory of the day stops at the explosion.
Sergeant Moncho came and sort of took over the platoon. I was well out of it at this point. Called for the quick reaction force.
Pash and the reserve force were scrambled, and they poured out of the base to help their stricken colleagues. When he got to the scene of carnage, Pash can remember going over to Halsey. Halsey had been a close friend of James Backhouse, who'd just been killed.
And I approached Halsey and said, "Mate, you got to grab your stretcher." And I couldn't understand what he was saying to me. So I shook him and I looked down at him. And at first I thought he was laughing hysterically. It just looked like that, it sounded like that. He was actually in complete tears, just sobbing. Halsey and Backeye had been really, really close friends. And it obviously just shaken Halsey.
Despite what he'd just witnessed, Halsey continued clearing routes with his metal detector. For his bravery, he would be mentioned in dispatches.
Other people in the platoon deserve it more than me, or if not everyone. Everyone should have got one.
Halsey's other friend, Brendan, was lying on the ground with terrible injuries to his legs and arms. Surgeons would later fight to save his limbs.
They've had to take tendons as well from in this arm to replace onto the back of this hand. So that's pretty much quite different parts of all the body they've had to put in for the arm to save that. But the legs, which looked initially the worst, they had to open all this as all part of the inside of my leg there. They've had to bring round to fill in the back where it's all missing.
The soldiers had to get their injured colleagues back to base as quickly as possible. They were now being fired on from several positions. Pash turned his attention to his injured boss.
The most severely wounded at that stage was Lieutenant Horsfall. And so it was a matter of manhandling Alex Horsfall onto the quad bike.
They raced with Alex back to the base.
He was just spasming, really, and he was using his stump. He was trying to push himself off the trailer just to keep him on the trailer. I had to lie on top of him.
Behind them, the walking wounded were gathered into a group. But as they set off, another daisy chain of IEDs exploded.
There was a lot of dust. Couldn't see anything. I couldn't hear anything either, really much.
Three men were killed instantly. Corporal Jonathan Horn, Rifleman Joseph Murphy, and Rifleman Daniel Simpson. Rifleman William Aldridge was severely injured and died later at Camp Bastion. The blasts narrowly missed Matthew Ramdeen, who saw the immediate aftermath.
I suppose we don't feel comfortable talking about it because you can take yourself back there very quickly. It's something you don't want to do. And it's a constant battle to forget it.
Meanwhile, Peter Sherlock was back in the base. He'd come down with heatstroke the day before and so had not been allowed out on the patrol. But he saw his dead and injured friends brought back in. He'd been especially close to one of those killed, Daniel Simpson.
I've got a memorial tattoo on my back. I've got Simpson's name in the middle and the other lad's names. It's like a living memorial for him.
Those with injuries were flown to Camp Bastion for further treatment. Because he was in such a bad way, Alex was then flown back to Selly Oak Hospital in Birmingham. The others remained at the base, and later that day, the terrible events they'd witnessed started to hit them.
It was starting to sink in, really, what had gone on, and people started breaking down about it, really getting upset about it. And you would find guys throughout the night, you know, you'd hear sobbing.
That was one day in July, but the men's tour didn't end there. Their patrols continued with the threat of IEDs until they left in October. 2009 remains the bloodiest year for British troops in Afghanistan, with 108 fatalities and over 500 wounded in action. Three years on, and after months in hospital, Alex has completed an army rehabilitation program. He's now able to lead an independent life with the help of a prosthetic leg and hand.
I like my cricket. I used to play a lot at school. I was a great wicketkeeper. I was quite nifty with the gloves, I think.
That goes out.
This is where I keep my my prosthetic legs. This is a great old leg that they give you at Headley Court. It's called the sea leg.
Despite horrific physical injuries, he doesn't seem to suffer from mental trauma.
When I left the army, I left in January 2012, and I've managed to keep working for the Ministry of Defence, and life's pretty much back to normal. The human body's got a wonderful knack of telling you to sort of get a grip and telling you to move on.
But Alex knows that others from his platoon haven't been able to get on with their lives so easily, and he hopes a reunion in 8 weeks' time could provide them with some support.
What I'm trying to do at the moment is just make sure I've got everyone's contacts from the platoon. This was a platoon t-shirt. It's got everyone there. It tells you a story, it reminds you of a lot of stories. Post-traumatic stress, it's a horrible disease, really. And I think by having a little reunion can be quite a good remedy, just to talk amongst yourselves about any problems that you've got.
Alex wants to prevent any more of his men reaching the point of despair experienced by another member of the platoon, Rifleman Alan Arnold. Alan had not been out on the patrol the day his five friends were killed, but he saw them brought back in. He'd spent his teenage years in Cirencester and fulfilled his dream of joining the army at the age of 17. As he passed through the Cataracts Training Center, he was molded into a soldier. His mother, Nikki, was proud of what her son had achieved.
He had ADD, which is attention deficit disorder. He was also severely dyslexic. So, you know, for him to do what he did, to be able to get in, yeah, he did it. A lot of people said he wouldn't, but he did.
After Catterick, Alan joined Alex's platoon. During the spring of 2009, with the rest of his friends, Alan was sent to Wishton in Sangin.
That was taken in Afghanistan. He just looked so happy in that photo. You know, before everything happened. It's one of my favourites, because he does look so happy and so young.
Then came the day the five men were killed, including his close friend William Aldridge, or Baby, as he was known. Alan called his mum from the base shortly afterwards.
He informed me his closest friend had died. Was gone. He just said that the baby had gone. That he had been killed. Yeah, he was crying that he'd lost his friends and so many in one go. And there was nothing that I could do to make it easier for him. You know, I couldn't cuddle him. I could just listen.
Like the others in the platoon, Alan's mental health after the incident was monitored by his senior officers. And he was given the chance to talk through what happened. Once back in the UK, he had some counselling through the army. But Nikki remembers the telephone calls he made to her from barracks.
A majority of the phone calls that I would receive would be 3-4 o'clock in the morning. He was usually absolutely wasted. And you'd say, why aren't you asleep? You know, it's 3 a.m, get to sleep. And it was, I can't sleep. He didn't want to sleep because of the nightmares. He would tell you in phone calls of hearing the lads crying out in the night, screaming in their sleep. Obviously having nightmares like he had.
During his Easter leave from barracks in 2011, Alan stayed with his sister, Abby, at her flat in Cirencester.
I think he left mine any time between about 3 and 5, and he ended up here.
On the 2nd of May 2011, rifleman Alan Arnold, at the age of 20, took his own life.
At first, I didn't really want to believe it. I couldn't believe that my brother had taken his own life. In the weeks after, a lot of people used to come down here and place flowers on a nearby bench just to pay their respects.
Alan took his own life. Because he felt that it was too hard to carry on anymore. The nightmares, the flashbacks, the memories, the loss, it was too much in the end for him to cope with. I suppose he saw it as the only way to get peace.
Alan's death came as a bitter blow for Alex, who'd led the platoon on the day and still felt a responsibility towards his former colleagues.
Very sadly, Rifleman Arnold took his own life. The last thing you want is for something like that to happen again. And it's hugely demoralizing, especially after the tour. Once you're back, once you think you're safe.
Alex is fearful that others from the platoon might follow Alan's example. It's an anxiety shared by Lucy Aldridge. Lucy is the mother of Alan's close friend, William, who was killed on the patrol less than 2 months after his 18th birthday. Lucy feels William's friends have become part of the family.
We stay in touch via Facebook, sometimes by telephone. A couple of the guys on Mother's Day will give me a call and say, Happy Mother's Day, Mum.
As well as trying to cope with her own grief for the loss of her son, Lucy has to deal with some of his friends telling her they're on the edge.
When you start getting messages from the lads that were serving in 9 Platoon, and they're very specific, mentioning the fact that they wish they'd died in Afghan and then they wouldn't be here dealing with what they're having to deal with now, the aftermath. That has a very, very deep impact on you.
One of the lads who's been in contact with Lucy is Holty.
What to do, just do it online or something?
Yeah.
It's now close to a month until the reunion, and he's moved out of his sister's place to live by himself near Doncaster. He's doing his best to hold down a manual job with a local company, but he is still haunted by Helmand. Maria works as an advisor in a drop-in centre around the corner from where he lives, and it was with her help that he got his job. Holty likes to call round from time to time for a chat.
How much is that SIA license?
I think Kevin's pushing against his demons, his PTSD, missing the army life. I think there's a massive hole to fill once they do get home.
It's taken time for Maria to win Holty's trust, and as she's got to know him, he's revealed more about what he saw on that terrible day in 2009.
I just don't know how a person can carry on after what he's been through, and he does. Seeing your friends and colleagues just blown away like that. And for what for?
Maria tries to help Holty get access to the services available to him. Responsibility for the mental health of veterans rests with the NHS. But charities also provide much-needed support. Combat Stress, the leading charity in the field, is in such demand that it handled 1,500 referrals in 2011, more than ever before. From initial contact to the start of treatment, it takes on average 12 to 16 weeks. While she waits for Holty to fill out the paperwork for Combat Stress, Maria's got him treatment through his local GP.
There is some help out there. I wouldn't have thought there was nearly enough. And accessing the services can be difficult. Why put them through weeks of waiting lists when they've already been through so much?
At the moment, Holty's receiving an hour of NHS counselling a week, and he's on medication, but he doesn't think the counselling is working.
Well, everything I've been to, I feel it hasn't really helped. I don't really like talking about things. Maria's been a big help.
Worry about it all the time. What they've been through and the memories, they're never going to go away, and they're going to have to battle with them for the rest of their life.
After the Helmand tour, Matthew Ramdean found it difficult to settle into civvy life because of his fear of attack. But over time, that has begun to fade. He's looking forward to the reunion, now just a few weeks away.
Everyone kind of went off and did their own thing for a period.
Hello. What's up?
We just need to stay in contact. We should stick together, you know, talk to each other a lot more.
What Matthew would most like to do is become a pilot. He's just finished his second year of engineering at college, and he's come to Farnborough Airshow, where he dreams of fulfilling his ambition. He thought the post-traumatic stress was behind him, but out of the blue in the summer of 2011, nearly 2 years after Afghanistan, it returned. He was back home in West London with his mother, Jo, and she saw up close his transformation.
He was fine, as in he was back in one piece. He wasn't missing a limb. There was no change moods. There was no outbursts. There was no night sweats that I was aware of. There was no waking up screaming. But obviously, it was there.
I don't know what can I say. It must have been always there. I guess I was trying to fight it myself, you know, trying to deal with it myself.
Unchecked, the PTSD threatened to get out of control.
He suddenly turned into a very army person, wanted to wear his greens the whole time, and would say to us, when you've seen your friends die, then you'll understand how it feels. Then that's when the anger just came out of nowhere. Punched the doors, start fights with his brother, have a go at me like he's never done before. And that's when he said, geez, you really need help. Very scary.
When I first got back, I guess I tried to deny it. Just keep myself busy, keep my mind active. You know, don't think about it, keep my mind active, kept myself busy. Yeah, but as I gradually got less busy, I guess I started to think about it more.
Joe and the rest of the family bore the brunt of it.
I'm in tears. Every day I'm in tears. Every day I'm waking up, going to work, thinking, what am I going to come back to? Has he killed his brother? Has he walked out the street and killed someone? Getting the help wasn't easy. And I rang the combat stress line, and they said, unless he does it himself, they can't do anything. And that's when I rang our local mental health, and they said he really needs some help. So they gave him anti-anxiety tablets, and within a week of taking that, he had changed. He stopped pacing, started to talk more, the temper, the anger all went, and they said that he definitely needs counselling to talk about it.
Matthew's old regiment pulled some strings with combat stress to fast-track him some counselling. And today, life is returning to normal. He's off the treatment, and the studies are going well. He relaxes by playing war games on his PS3.
I feel better now. I feel like I'm getting somewhere now.
One person Matthew expects to see in a few weeks at the reunion is his good friend, Peter Sherlock.
I think the idea of us all getting back together, the original 9 platoon boys that were all out there, I just reckon it's going to be amazing, to be honest.
Peter is trying to control the drinking and finds that sailing on the Solent provides much-needed distraction from the horrors of Helmand.
I go in my own little zone. I don't have to think about negative thoughts.
Sailing also gives him the chance to sort out his priorities.
I've got a beautiful baby girl, and her name's Hope Liberty, and she was conceived not long after I got back from Afghan, and coming back from Afghan, I decided that I liked the name Hope. And then I saw a picture of the Statue of Liberty, and it stands for, like, freedom and all of that. And Hope Liberty, I thought, had a nice ring to it.
Peter and Hope's mother have split up, and Hope lives with her, so he doesn't get to see his daughter as much as he would like.
This is the most recent picture I got of her. I like wondering what she's up to, what she's doing, how she is, how much taller she is, what she's into. I'd love to teach her how to sail. That'd be a dream.
Spurred on by his love for his daughter, he's slowly getting his life back on track. He's spending less time down the pub, and he now lives in his nan's old house near Southampton.
Right, if you pour that in there then, Peter, we'll have one each.
Together with his dad, Derek, he's doing it up with a view to selling it. The two of them work for a local company, painting and decorating. Derek as a manager and Peter as an apprentice.
That's a good boy, though. We'll never know what they've gone through. He goes quiet and he's on Facebook. He had a picture there the other day and I said, oh, I haven't seen that one before, Pete. Who's that and who's this? And I was in tears because he said, you know, he's dead. He's committed suicide. We're blessed that he's home. But it's the mental thing that bothers us. You know, how is he going to cope with that? Thankfully, you know, we're here for him.
Peter is coming to terms with his Helmand experience, but it's a constant struggle. He can't get a proper night's rest because his sleep is still haunted by nightmares.
I had a couple while we were still in Afghan, to be honest. After the nasty day happened, I had a few then, and really it started when we got back, and it's not stopped.
I ask him, how are you sleeping? Are you still having nightmares? And he just says, well, I've had nightmares every night since. You know, and that's 3 years. We personally have encouraged him to get some professional help, but he's quite a proud young man and he thinks he can cope with it on his own.
You wake up with quite a jump, quite a fright and a bit of a sweat on sometimes. So sleeping can be pretty rough, to be honest. But a lot of it, in a way, I feel I'm sort of lucky because it happens in my sleep more than when I'm awake. Whereas for some of the lads I know, they get it while they're awake as well as when they're asleep.
Peter's nightmares at the moment are about his mates Holty and Matthew Ramdeen.
In my nightmare, we were in Wishton and we'd gone out and we put the ladder up and Holty was first man over. But when he went down the ladder, he'd been blown up. And I've also had it with Ramdeen. So it's like reliving it. You think it's real.
Back in London, with the reunion just 3 weeks away, Alex is trying to locate as many from the platoon as possible.
Some people, I think, are on their sort of seventh phone since then.
I can do my best. I'm still sort of trying to track down half of the platoon and sort of figure out where they're all hiding. So
the venue is a botanical gardens in Edgbaston, just outside of Birmingham.
He wants to make it more of a special occasion, and has suggested black tie.
From the guys I've spoken to, they're all quite keen about the black tie option. And, you know, opportunity to dress up, look cool for a bit. It's always quite good fun.
Even so, Alex is still worried that some will slip through the net and miss out on the reunion.
I'll do my best to sort of try and push people into coming, maybe sort of twist an arm.
There's been chatter on Facebook between the lads about the reunion, but Holty has sent out a message saying he's feeling down and they're concerned he might not come.
I'm most worried about Holty. Holty's one of the more sensitive fellas who is a bit of a roller coaster. He sent me a message the other day telling me that he's a bit depressed. The message says, to be honest, mate, don't think this civvy life is for me and don't really want to go back in the army. In a low mood at the minute, nothing is exciting me.
Because the reunion is fast approaching, Peter and Matthew decide they must visit Holty to raise his morale and make sure he attends.
We're gonna go on down to see Holty down in Doncaster. Probably end up having a few drinks later on.
So yeah, going up north.
When they get there, they're relieved to find he appears to be in a better mood.
This is Dash. Little Dashy.
Cute, isn't he? How's your lab life going?
Shit.
Any takers? What about yours, Randy? Been a while for you, though, isn't it?
Holty remains a hero in the platoon. He was the man with the metal detector at the front of the patrols whose job it was to find the deadly IEDs.
To go out and know that you're going to be pretty much the first person that's going to get hit if you do miss one, and to be able to go out and do that every day, especially after seeing things kick off as well, I think he's got balls of steel for that.
The next morning, with the sun shining for once, the lads decide to take Holty to Skegness to help him clear his troubled mind.
Oof! I'm gonna be sick!
I'm not interested in making new friends. I feel more alone now. Well, not right this minute. But yeah, I feel more alone since I got out than I did when I was in.
Not long ago, I wanted to be totally by myself and left alone. And it was a pretty dang day. And I phoned Holty and he wanted exactly the same thing.
Reassured him, and if I was there, I would have given him a cuddle or not, I guess. Well, it's just one of the things, isn't it?
It's true, though, isn't it?
You don't need to say, oh, don't worry, mate, everything's going to be all right.
Yeah.
You just say, yeah, man up.
that's about it, yeah. Man up, carry on.
Holty wants to go to the reunion, and he can see its importance.
Because it'll get everyone back together. We've been through so much together, and I think that's what makes us unique and a special platoon.
But they know that Holty is still up and down, and so they can't be certain that he'll attend the reunion. When Matthew and Peter return home, he'll be alone again in his flat. By contrast, when Matthew started to suffer post-traumatic stress, he was living with his mother, Jo, and she was able to get help for him. Even so, she remains appalled by how difficult it was to get him treatment.
For me, it was disgusting the way I had to do it. It's a long process, and you have to fight for it. If you have someone who's really, really needs the help there and then, it's not there. The help isn't there. And that's what scared me the most.
As for Alan Arnold, he was still in the army when he took his own life, although he was on leave at the time. His mother, Nikki, doesn't believe her son got the help he needed. She thinks he was let down by the military.
Angry, very angry. You can't just look after their physical well-being. You know, send them to the doctor, send them to the dentist. You have to look after their mental health as well. They need help to cope with what they've seen and what they've done. They have to have the counselling, the professional help to learn how to live with it.
Alan's regiment was two rifles, and its commanding officer for the 2009 tour was Brigadier Robert Thompson. He will not speak about Alan's case specifically, but he does accept that some soldiers with mental health issues may have slipped through the net.
I think that it's very difficult to say that I didn't miss people, because these are difficult issues to be able to tackle to absolute fidelity. But what I can say is I was confident that we had put the right processes in place. And as a regiment, as an army, we take the care of our people absolutely as a priority.
And he has a message for our lads who have left the regiment.
Anybody who feels that they haven't been looked after by the regiment gets in touch with us now. We are a family regiment. There is no sense that we would want not to be seen to be looking after our own.
It's nearing the end of the summer, and the reunion is virtually upon them. Alex has come to London's Jermyn Street to take up an offer from Emma Willis, a bespoke shirt maker.
Hello, Emma.
Alex, hi.
How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Yeah, very well.
She's offered to make the men the shirts they'll need for the reunion, free of charge.
I thought it was definitely appropriate that our great servicemen are looking very smart in black tie.
After his spell in hospital, Emma met Alex at the Headley Court Rehab Centre.
I started going there 3 years ago, having heard a programme on Radio 4 about it. I wanted to try and work out a way of doing something. And then it struck me, shortly after, I could do the bespoke shirts for them. I can make the shirt to fit all their body measurements.
I've probably put on a little bit of weight around the neck.
OK, so a lot of muscle, a lot of time in the gym.
Muscle.
OK. Very early on, he was very, very thin and characteristic chain smoking.
Emma has a clothing factory in Gloucester and makes shirts for free for disabled servicemen and women.
So you tell me which one you prefer.
I think I've always sort of preferred these ones rather than the pleated ones.
I know the dinner will be amazing. I can guarantee there will be so much laughing.
Take care. Next time.
It's lovely to see you. And good luck with all your plans.
Yes, I'll do my best.
Thank you very much.
See you soon.
All the best.
Bye.
But at the 11th hour, just before the reunion, there's a hitch. Holty is in a bad way again and doesn't think he'll be able to attend.
Sometimes negative thoughts, like, overwhelm in me, I don't know, and it's just, I could go for days without talking to anybody or just seeing anybody.
Although meeting his old friends may help, he's not sure he can face the idea of company.
I get into a like a distant mood. I don't want to talk to anybody. Don't want to see anybody. I just want to be alone. At the minute, I'm just taking things day to day. I've not really got any plans. I don't know really, whatever happens, happens.
Finally, it's the 18th of August and the evening of the reunion in Birmingham.
I know people's voicemails better than I know them.
Whilst Bucks Fizz is served on the terrace, Alex is still trying to round up a few stragglers.
Just wondering when you're going to turn up.
I am just trying to track you down. Just turn up, and we'll see you when you get here.
Do turn up at any point. Anyway, take care. Bye bye.
I've been on Find the Voice all day.
Give up. Useless, is it?
Yeah, he promised me he's coming.
We've sort of finally made it. We're still sort of waiting for a few more to sort of turn up, but I think, you know, the turnout's good.
For Matthew and Peter, it's a special moment to be with their old comrades again.
It's brilliant, getting back with all the lads again, having a few drinks, getting all the army banter, and after not seeing everyone for so long. Quite shocking to see everybody scrubbed up all right.
Good, mate. I just worried where it's going.
The boss put some money behind the bar.
It was really great having a formal dinner together, all of us looking smart. Haven't seen some of the lads since Afghanistan, to be honest.
I mean, but you still having sort of further ops and things?
Yeah, on my arm.
Yeah.
At the very last moment, Halty is persuaded by his old mate from the platoon, Brendan, to attend. And they travelled down from Doncaster together.
First time I were in a black tie. I looked smart. Everyone did. I just thought it might be last chance that I'd like see everyone together again. So I thought it's good. The lads that were lost over there, they always come up in conversations. It's just all the good memories.
The reunion has achieved everything that Alex hoped for.
It's a wonderful venue. It's a wonderful sort of get-together. Never seen 9 Platoon look so smart.
On the night, Holty was brilliant. He was back to how he was when we were all together before we even went out there. And he had a good laugh. He got a bit tipsy and started acting like Holty. So it did him a world good, I think.
It's great to sort of see the guys back together again. A lot to sort of catch up about. It's a good time.
It's now September and 1 month on. For Alan Arnold's sister, Abby, the grief is still raw.
I don't think I could put into words how much I miss Alan at all. There'll be a song on the radio that'll remind me of him, or somebody will walk past who's wore the same deodorant or aftershave as him, and you get that gut-wrenching feeling in your stomach, like you want to be sick because you're never going to see him again.
Our lads are approaching the future with fresh hope. Peter is helping to do up the house of his friend Gemma, and she's encouraging him to stay off the drink.
I'm seeing a lot of Gemma, and she doesn't like drink and all that going on. I cut the drink down massively, and I will get her.
And even though he's still refusing to get professional help, the nightmares are easing up a little.
You could never forget times like that. That's going to be with you for life, no matter if you talk to anybody or not. I still get bad nightmares, but nowhere near as bad as they were. It's nice being able to sleep properly now.
He's determined to become the dad he thinks his daughter Hope deserves.
Love her to pieces, but I don't get to see her often enough. And it's heartbreaking not seeing her. Agony. I'll keep writing her letters. I've got a half-written letter at home now. and I've got to finish writing it and I'll send it off.
Matthew has started the third year of his engineering course and he sees it as another small step towards his ultimate ambition.
It's always been a dream for me to, you know, fly a plane myself. I want to enrol in the RAF, become a fighter pilot.
Yeah, let's go, let's go.
So load is coming up and we are rolling now.
Wow, that was cool.
How's that?
Yeah.
The future's bright, you know. And yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to it, 100%.
Holty has moved back in with his parents. And life's still tough.
I'm just fed up with the way that I'm feeling every day. I'm just not getting any enjoyment from anything. This life that I'm in now is pretty boring.
He wants to turn his army experience into something more positive. He dreams of starting a new life, if possible, far away in America.
Obviously, I've got experience from army, which might help me to get into the police force in America. I'm going to try my hardest to get a visa and that. I just want something new, something exciting.
The surviving members of 9 Platoon are all trying to move on with their lives, each in their own way. For some at least, the demons that have haunted them since that fateful day are gradually being left behind.
For details of organisations which offer advice and support, go online to bbc.co.uk/actionline or call the BBC Action Line to hear recorded information on 08000 680 133. Lines are open 24 hours and are free from a landline. Mobile operators will charge.